Recording.
Ok, c'est bon, tu m'entends? So let's restart our course on fusion category. So we are still working in monoidal category. So yesterday we finished by providing some example of what of strict monoidal category. So example, we will continue today, and then we will state the MacLane strictness theorem and prove it, or at least start to prove it. Maybe we will have no time to finish the proof. So example, of strict monoidal category. So yesterday, we mentioned NC. So today, so NC is the monoidal category of Hondo functor of C, so functor from C to C. So let's consider the first monoidal category called sets with a line, an overline like that. So the object of this category are non-negative integers. Morphism. So Homme set in the this category set between the integer n and the integer m and n is the the set of map, so the maps, set of maps, maps F from N to N. So wait, let's write it less formally. Let be the set of maps from 0 to m minus 1 to 0 n minus 1. Not enough. So we consider all the possible maps between these two sets. So we call this such map, it's called a map from M to N. So in practice, it's a map from this set to this set. And so the Homme set is all such map. And so the tensor structure, so tensor structure M N, it's the product of the integer. And for so if for the morphism, the tensor product of morphism. So if you have fi from mi to ni, so two map as above, we define f1 tensor f2 from m1, m2 to n1, n2 as follow. Defined as, so let, so we take this map and take define as, so you take two map and you consider the tensor product as follow. F1 tensor F2 of M2X plus Y equal N2 F1 of X F2 of Y. Well, so this is N. With, so x between 0 and m1, y between 0 and n, m2. Okay. So you see, this is a way to encode every number between 0 and m1, m2 minus 1. But to get so you so it's okay, you have this tensor product. So the so exercise show that set is a strict monoidal category which is and is, so maybe the first part of the statement is completely direct, but the second part is a bit more interesting and less direct. So and which and is monoidally equivalent. Monoidally equivalent to the usual monoidal category set of finite set, I mean a finite the monoidal category of finite set. And so this is an example of strict monoidal category, and the usual category monoidal category of finite set need to show also it is monoidally equivalent to that. So the monoidal category of finite set is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. So by sets, I mean finite sets. So I don't need to. Category. Okay, and the hint, consider embedding sets like that. So in fact, this embedding will be the what you need. So this will be the functor encoding the monoidal equivalence. Okay. Okay. So next example. Okay, example. So now consider the example. Next example. Linear version of sets. So it's called k vec. So let k be field. So it will be almost as before, but you replace the map by matrix. So the object, as before, there are non-negative integers. The morphism, so homme qui est avec mn, this will be m times m by n matrices over k, where the composition compose as matrices. So the composition of this morphism are the composition of matrices, the product of matrices. And the tensor structure, as before, the multiplication for the object, multiplication of the integer. And for the morphism, so you consider an m by mi by ni matrices. So this is in the homme k vec mini, which is equal to m mini k, which is by definition, and the tensor structure of that will be given m I n 2 n 1 n 2 by the Kronecker, what is called the Kronecker product, I will explain in the next slide, of f1 and f2. So the Kronecker product of two matrix. So what is a Kronecker product? The Kronecker product, the natural way. So Kronecker product. Kronecker product. So you have A in M times N of K, B, which is in P times Q, okay, like that. And let's call A like that, Aij, the entries. And we don't need to consider the entries of B. So the Kronecker product, so it is denoted by a tensor symbol, tensor product symbol. So you just like that. So A1NB, AM1B, etc., AMNB. Is in M of M P times N Q. You see, these are blocks. This is a block in the matrix. And so you define this matrix by this block. So this means you multiply every element, every entries of B by A11. Here, every entries of B by A1n, etc. So it's defined by block like that. So example to see. Let's see one example of a Kronecker product. So if 1, 2, 3, 4, Kronecker product, 0, 5, 6, 7. So so this definition of the Kronecker product is not in the book we are following. I just took this from Wikipedia. And I also took the example from Wikipedia. So like that, 6, 7, 2, 0, 5, 6, 7, 3, 0, 5, 6, 7, 4, 0, 5, 6, 7. So it's equal to 0, 5, 6, 7, 0, 10, 12, 14, 0, 15, 18, 21, 0, 20, 24, 28. Okay. Okay. So this is a way. This is the tensor structure, the Kronecker product for this category. So as before, exercise as before, show that Quebec is a strict monoidal category and is monoidal equivalent to the usual category Quebec of finite dimensional category of finite dimensional K vector space. Here, this was category of finite set. Category finite set. Okay, and the hint is as before, consider embedding K-vec. So this functor will provide you this will be a monoidal functor and this will be provide the equivalence. Okay. We can do the same thing for the category of graded vector space. So I will not explain in details. But the exercise will be to do the same thing for exercise. Define a strict monoidal category K vec G, where G is a finite group. Maybe we don't need finite group. Maybe we don't need finite, but does not matter. So define a strict monoidal category K vec like that, which is monoidally equivalent to the usual one K vec G. So the category of K vector space graded by the group G. And so you do that. So this is an exercise, and the int, so the object of K vec G are set valued function on G. So like that, f from g to z, so the non-negative integer, with such that, so with, so the inverse of zero should be finite, which means that the only inverse of zero should be finite. Or the inverse, so wait, I have a doubt here. I have a small doubt. Let me check. Finitely many non-zero value. Finitely many non-zero value. So this is not correct. The complement. So the inverse of the complement of zero. So I guess, write like that. F inverse of the positive. So I mean finitely many non-zero value. So like that. The positive. So if you restrict to the positive, you should have only finitely many one which are non-zero. So you can write it like that. So let me do that cleaner. F inverse of z positive should be of cardinal, of finite cardinal. Okay. Okay. This is an exercise. So what is the remark? So we remark that the most of the usual monoidal category. So sets vec G, etc. should be regarded as non-strict, but are monoidally equivalent to strict one, as we just show in this example. So all the usual monoidal categories are non-strict in general, cannot be considered as strict, but they all are, at least the one we've seen before, they all are monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. And so I leave all that in as exercise, but so it's true. And in fact, this work in general, this work in general, and this is the MacLane. This is a MacLane strictness theorem. So this is the MacLane strictness theorem. So we will prove, or we will start, we will begin the proof of that after the poll. We can start. So this is a theorem. So any monoidal category is monoidally equivalent to a strict monoidal category. So let's recall, because I did not recall strict, we defined strict yesterday. Strict means that the associativity constraints are trivial. And and the unity constraint is trivial also. So MacLane strictness theorem says that, in fact, theoretically, we don't need to care about associativity constraint, because there is always a monoidal equivalent to a strict monoidal category. But in practice, we need to care about the associativity constraint, because the point is that the strict monoidal category you will get is less practice, in fact, because it will have much more in fact much many many more much more element in the isomorphism class of the object. So you have the object of the category, you have this isomorphism class, and in fact the strict monoidal category you will get, the trick in fact or the is that you will have much more element in the isomorphism class of the object. So the category you get is, in practice, is not so useful, at least if you want to deal with the problem like the problem of categorification of fusion ring or something like that. You really need, in fact, you cannot avoid the use of the associativity constraint. Because when you want to consider categorification of fusion ring, in fact, you need to consider isomorphism class where with only one element, which is called skeletal. I will define that later. So skeletal, any isomorphism class has only one element. In fact, I already mentioned that at the beginning of the course. Anyway, but it's still, so we will prove this theorem, and this will be the first big theorem of the course. By big theorem, I mean something deep and long to prove, and really, this is a really deep theorem, and the proof, it's quite long compared to the other theorem we proved up to now. Okay, so so before providing the details of the proof, so before the detailed proof, let us mention the idea of the proof. So the idea is the following. So we will give an equivalence, monoidal equivalence, between C and the monoidal subcategory of the endofunctor of C. So some monoidal subcategory of the endofunctor of C, the monoidal subcategory of endofunctor of C, so the subcategory of right C module functor. So of course everything will be defined in details later. So by what do we mean by right C module functor? So we mean something like that. So we will, this will have more details definition later. Something like that. So you have a functor F, and you made a tensor product on the right, and this is isomorphic to F, and you put it inside. So this right C module functor, like that. So you consider the subcategory of functor commuting like that with the tensor product on the right, like that. And so we will do that in details. And the non. So here we provide a non-categorical analogous of above subcategory. So a non-categorical analogous, so a monoidal category is a categorical analogous of a monoid. So what is the analogous of this construction for a monoid? So every monoid M is isomorphic to the monoid of maps F from M to M such that FMN equal FMN. for all m n in m. And this is nothing but such. How to what was this? ID of the proof. So ID of the proof for this statement for non-categorical. You consider so f of m. This is equal to f of f of I m. I is a neutral. And by definition of the map, this is f I times m. And you see then f is nothing but the map which m maps to f I of m. So the map, the left multiplication by f I. So you have a map. So you take f, you consider f of the neutral, and then you can see directly that this f is nothing but the multiplication by f I. And conversely, for any left multiplication map, any left multiplication map commute with have such commutation. And this is exactly the idea of the proof. So this is the idea of the proof is a non-categorical framework, but in the categorical framework, the MacLean strictness theorem will be exactly just a categorical version of that. So here you can do that in one line. So in the categorical framework, we need several pages, but the idea is just that. Okay. Okay. So proof. So now we can make the proof. In fact, the proof. So we will first define this subcategory. So this is the main theorem here. So proof. So we start from a monoidal category. So for a monoidal category C, let C tilde like that. Back then, I don't know how to read this notation. I put some tilde vertically. Let's call that C tilde. I don't know. In the book, the usual tilde is like that, but in the book they wrote like that. I don't know how to pronounce that, but let's say that C tilde. Or C. In fact, in the literature, you can see also C strict. People call that C with str like that. But in the book, they wrote like that. Anyway. So we will define C tilde. This will be the subcategory here. So how to define that very precisely? So yeah, this so it's not, yeah, so C tilde will not really be a subcategory because this will be defined, the object will be pair. the object will be pair. So it's not really a subcategory. So that's why I put a quotation like that. Anyway. So what is the object? So we need to define this in details. So the object are pairs FC, where F from C to C. So F is a functor from C to C, which means that this F is an object of that. So I guess the subcategory here is when you consider this ctilde and you take the forgetful functor. And from FC, you only take F, and then you really have a subcategory. But this is not a subcategory. You need a pair. Anyway. So it's a pair. So to be clear, it's not. Not really a subcategory. It is after forgetful functor. Forgetful functor. Okay, so it's a pair. So C, what time is it? So F is a functor, and C, the natural transformation, which is natural isomorphism, in fact, isomorphism. such that, and here we will see, so it's a natural isomorphism encoding the fact that the functor it deal with the right the multiplication by tensor product on the right. So if x like that, fx tensor y isomorphic to fx tensor y. So you need that. And a diagram and the following diagram. So we will see the diagram after the pause. Commuting diagram. So now this is a pause. And the forgetful functor. So you have C tilde to C FC maps to F. Okay. To end of F, sorry, not to C. End of C. Yeah. Okay, let's restart. Oof. For the term. Okay. So, as I said, you need to define a kind of subcategory of the endofunctor, which deal with the right C-module form, which deal with the right multiplication tensor, the tensor on the right like that. And to do so, it's not really a subcategory because it's a pair. But up to the forgetful functor, what you get, the image of that by the forgetful functor is a subcategory. But what we are interested in is that. So the objects are pair. It's not really a subcategory, but it's almost a subcategory in some sense. So, okay, so you have pair F, the element of the endofunctor, the functor from C to C. And C, it's an isomorphism. And in fact, it's always like that in monoidal category theory. You always, because you, as yesterday, we define also something by pair. And the second element of the pair encode the structure. So, yeah, it's very generic construction. The Drinfeld center also will be defined like that. So you get new category like that. So this C should satisfy the following commuting diagram. So it's a big diagram, which is as big as the Pentagon axiom. And we will see that, in fact, it in some cases, it will be equivalent to the Pentagon axiom. So you start from F X tensor Y tensor Z. And here you apply first X, so isomorphism X, CXY. And for the other component, you just put the identity of them. So here, then you will put Y inside. So FX tensor Y tensor Z. And now let's apply C X tensor Y tensor Y Z. So Z will be inside. So it's F of X tensor Y tensor Z. Okay. Here on the right, we take the associativity constraint. So X Y Z. And so you get F of X tensor Y tensor Z. And again, you apply the C isomorphism, so C, Y, Z. So Y, Z will be inside, so we will get X tensor Y, Z. And for going from there to there, you just need to apply the associativity constraint inside the functor F. X, Y. So this commute, this symbol is mean that the diagram commute. usually like that, anyway. Okay, so for the diagram commute. So for all X, Y, Z in C, all object in C. Okay. So you have the object. So the objects are such pair. so of course, not every endofunctor can be such a F. You need an endofunctor which for which you have this commuting, for which you can you have this isomorphism. So not every Hondo functor deal with the tensor product on the right like that. But for those who deal with that, then you have the extra structure C. So you fixed one isomorphism. And the one isomorphism you fix should also satisfy this diagram, which is just a way to remove the ambiguity, in fact. Because you have an ambiguity. If you don't put this diagram, then you can go from there or from there, and this could be ambiguous. So you assume the diagram commute and everything is fine. This is a definition. Okay, so you have the object. Now, what about the morphism? The morphism for this category. So, So morphism from one such object to another such object. So I define as follow. So you have a natural transformation you call also it theta. So in the book they call the natural transformation with the same symbol as the morphism. So there is a so this one has the same symbol, but they are not the same object. Here it's a morphism from that to that, and this is a natural transformation from this functor to this functor. Anyway, so you have you fix a natural transformation such that you have a commuting diagram. Okay, so I will need to label this diagram, because we need to mention that later. So this diagram will be labeled with a star, and the diagram we will write here will be labeled with two stars. So the following diagram commute. So F1 of X tensor Y. You apply theta on the left component and the identity on the right component. So F2 X tensor Y. Here, you apply the C isomorphism. C1, in fact, C1 XY. So Y will go inside the functor. So like that. Same thing here, C2 of XY, F2 of XY. And here it's, you apply theta of XY only. So this commute. Again, this remove ambiguity, in fact. And so for all x, y, is. So these commuting diagrams will be labeled with two stars like that. Two stars. And this one star here. Okay. So you have the object, we have the morphism. Now we need to know how to compose the morphism. Composition of morphism. In fact, yeah, the main part or the the biggest part of the proof will be just to define the category. And once the category is defined, in fact, the proof then will be completely automatic. After that, the proof will be very short. Okay, so composition of morphism. So given by vertical composition of natural transformation. And I will define what I mean by vertical and horizontal composition after. So vertical composition of natural transformation. So let's recall or define, but you can write it as a recall or definition. Definition. So vertical composition. So recall. Vertical composition. So in general, you have two. So now we this definition is out of the proof. It's just a recall like that. So you have two categories, C and C prime. So out of the proof. C and C prime and you have three functors between C and C prime F1, F2, F3 and two natural transformation. So you have the natural transformation alpha from F1 to F2 and the natural transformation beta from F2 to F3. And that, so the horizontal, the vertical composition of natural transformation is just beta alpha. So beta alpha. Like that. Vertical composition. So vertical composition beta alpha. So it's a vertical. And now you can compose horizontally. And I will define what is horizontal composition because we will need it for the definition of a tensor product of morphism. So the tensor product of morphism will be given by the horizontal composition. So let's define it right now. So horizontal composition so you have C prime. You have F prime, G prime. And here you have eta, and here eta prime. So the horizontal composition. Will be like that. So you have how to write that. C prime prime F prime composé F J prime composé J and here like that eta prime eta. So it's horizontal. So the horizontal composition here. maybe I can write another color. Horizontal. Okay. So this is horizontal. This is vertical here. Okay. So this was out of the proof. Define these two notions. Okay, so the composition of morphism is given by a vertical composition of natural transformation. Okay. Now the tensor product of, so we'll define the tensor product of object, and then the tensor product of morphism will be horizontal composition of natural transformation. So tensor product. Tensor product of object. So F one C one tensor F two C two. So it is F one F2. So, in fact, in the book, they remove the composition symbol. So, this means F1 composed with F2, but they just write F1, F2. And a natural isomorphism C defined as follows, where C is defined as follow. So C as follow. So we will define C by as a composition. We will compose two map we know, and this will give C. So you start from you want to start from F1 F F2. Yeah, so then I write the symbol of compositions. Anyway, let's write it. I'm more comfortable with the symbol. So of X, tensor Y. So you start from that. So this is equal to F1 of F2 of X, tensor Y. Here we can use the C map, the C isomorphism for the first object, for C1. So you have C1 and F2 of X, Y. So you put then the Y inside. So you have F1 of F2 of X, tensor Y. And then here we want to use the C2 inside F1. So F1 will put C2 inside. x and y, and it is f1 of f2 of x tensor y. And this is what f1 composed with f2 x tensor y. So we started from that. We got that, and this is what we want to define such a C. So C will be from there to there. So you have F1 composed with F2 X tensor Y. Maybe I can not just need to write a single like that. So this is F1 C2 XY composed with C1 F2 of XY. So CXY is equal to that F1 C2XY composed with C. So I can write like that. CXY equal. Okay. So this is a way to define the tensor product of objects. Now, what about the tensor product of morphism? Tensor product of morphism. So this is the horizontal, what I wrote, horizontal composition of natural transformation. Composition of natural transformation. You see, the tensor of object is given by a composition here. So you can define the tensor of morphism by the horizontal, because you have the composition as here. So it's a, yeah. Okay. Exercise. C tilde is a strict monoidal category with unit equal identity functor. So this is not the end of the proof, of course. We just defined a strict monoidal category from C. Now we need to prove that C and C tilde are monoidally equivalent. But in fact, C tilde was made for that. So from now, the proof will be completely automatic. Je peux allumer la lumière. Merci. Okay. The proof will be automatic up to the ID we said in about monoid. So you need to consider what I wrote here. So you the ID here. Now we correctly defined the category. We can just apply this idea here automatically. Okay. So we need to show there is monoidal. So it remain to make to find a monoidal equivalence between C and C tilde. Okay. So consider, so this monoidal equivalence will be the following. So we will prove that this L is, so consider is a monoidal equivalence. So consider the following. Following left multiplication functor L from C to C tilde. So L of X is the functor left multiplication by X. And the C natural isomorphism is given by the associativity constraint, like that. And I will explain a bit. And the functor L maps the function just to F tensor identity. So you leave a blank space. So if you call so just to better understand what we are defining here. So usually the comment I put in green like that. So let f of x be the functor of a left tensor by x. So you have fx of y tensor z. So you have the C isomorphism. So it's fxy tensor z. But this is equal to x tensor y tensor z. And this is equal to x tensor y tensor z. So in fact, it is here. It's natural to consider X the associativity constraint like that. So that's why we wrote. We can use AX because this corresponds to here. So. this correspond to that. So we can leave two blank space for X and for Y and Z. Okay, this was just a comment. Okay, so of course we need to this need to satisfy the diagram star with one star here, but in fact the commuting diagram star is exactly here, I mean, the pentagon diagram. The pentagon diagram. So it's okay. So you have, as I said, here you have five components. So in this case of the functor L, in fact, this is exactly the pentagon diagram. So this is automatically satisfied. So so this is okay. So it's really, this is really an object of C tilde. So this is an element of ANSI also. Yeah. So, what time is it? 2 minutes. So we will need, so let's show. We will now show that L is a monoidal equivalence. Monoidal equivalence. And for so, we will use, so we will again write something outside of the proof. Here it's out of the proof. An equivalent way to prove that something is a monoidal equivalence. It's an equivalence. So a functor. A functor f from C to D is an equivalence. Not a monoidal equivalence, just an equivalence of category. If and if it is so full, faithful, and essentially surjective. So I guess I already mentioned that a bit at the in the first lecture. But here we really need that because we will check every point. We will check it is full, faithful, and essentially surjective. This is a way. It is proved to be an equivalence. So full, faithful. So I will recall the definition. And essentially surjective. So full, faithful mean that x1 so the map c f of x f of y f of f is injective. So you get the points. Full means surjective, faithful means injective. So if you have the two, it's bijective. And I already mentioned that, in fact, monoyl equivalence, you have a bijection on the morphism. An essentially surjective means that for all D objects in D, there exists an object in C such that, so I should not write C. Anyway, C here is not the C before. So let's for all Y in D, Z, no. For all Z in D and X in C. There is S in C such that F of X equals C. Okay. So essentially surjective. So you see, this has something to do with what I said before, a skeletal, in fact. A skeletal, you have only one element by isomorphism class. So this is related to the notion of essentially surjective. Okay, so this is out of the proof. So we define these three notions. And now, maybe we will have time for one of the 3 points, but not for the other. Let's start to remain 7 minutes. Okay, so let's show that the functor L is essentially surjective. So let us first prove that L is essentially surjective. So claim any element, any object in C tilde is isomorphic to L of F1, something like that. And you should understand that as exactly as before here. Where is it? I lost. Yeah, here. You see F of E here. So any F for a monoid is defined as F of with F of E left multiplication. This is exactly the same thing here. Any object is isomorphic with F of one. Like that, here. Why? So proof of the claim. Proof of the claim. Claim. 5 minutes. So by definition, we have fx tensor y isomorphic to f of x tensor y. So now you have f of y, which is equal to f of one tensor y. This is what we call the convention. Convention. the convention inside F, in fact, one tensor Y is equal to Y. This is isomorphic to F of one tensor Y, because you apply the map here, C1 Y. Okay, so now it's a bit shorter. Or maybe this is just the idea. I have no time, no more time. I have no time to finish. I cannot even prove the claim. So the idea is as follows. So you have the end will be next week. The idea was as follows. So you have any f of y, it's just isomorphic to f1 tensor y. So so you have the f1 here, from the f1 here. But now we need to prove that this L, it's not only the F, you have also the C, etc. So you have a much thing to prove. Okay. So I should stop here, and next week I will restart from the claim. So next week I will restate the claim. Okay. So let's stop here. Arrêtez pas.